Great. Well, welcome everyone and good morning. We are here today at the second meeting of the Senate Standing Committee on Agriculture for the 2022 legislative session. Joining us this morning is the ranking member of the Senate Agriculture Committee, Senator George Borrello. We have Senator Brisport, Senator Comrie, Senator May, Senator Ramos, Senator Helming, and Senator Jordan. Thank you all so much for coming on this morning. I also want to say thank you to the incredible staff who makes all of this happen. Thanks for all of your work. And before we have a shorter agenda, so before we get into the few bills that we have, I am delighted to introduce our special guest this morning, Benjamin Halton from Cornell University College of Agriculture and Life Sciences. Ben is the 12th Ronald P. Lynch Dean of the College of Agriculture and Life Sciences and a Cornell University Professor of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology, as well as Global Development. He is really on the forefront and a complete expert on especially the ties between agriculture and the climate crisis and the environment. And I thought it would be really great for us to hear from him today on those connections and how agriculture plays such an important part in really solving the climate crisis. And so with that, I know, Ben, you have a PowerPoint with us. So why don't I hand it over to you and you take it away.
Great. Okay, just give me one moment here to figure out how to share the screen. And
as you're doing that, I'll say too, we will be taking, we'll have a short Q&A session after this. So everyone feel free to ask questions.
Okay, terrific. Well, hopefully you can just see one slide at this time, not like two. Okay, great. Well, Senator Hinchey, thank you. It's a real pleasure to have this chance to meet with the committee. I know I've met with a few of you, some in person, but mainly via Zoom, and it's just a real privilege, you know, to continue to serve this wonderful state of New York through the land grant mission. And I'm going to spend, let's say, 5 minutes giving a sort of rapid fire perspective on how we envision sort of an optimistic future through which agriculture, environment, and climate can unite as a powerful weapon in this incredible battle that we know we're all facing, this challenge of climate. By way of background, I'm a climate scientist. I've worked on the global climate problem for about 25 years, including publishing a lot of papers on forecasting the future. And the past, I would say 7 or 8 years, I've really focused on how can we bend the carbon curve, you know? So that's really my research expertise, and I will talk a bit about that today. If you remember anything from what I say, I think the most important points are, clearly we have a climate challenge. It's getting worse, we know why. And most importantly, I know we can solve this issue by fusing the strengths of research, of our private sector, public sector, all working hand in hand to get the CLCPA launched for great force. And it's wonderful to be a part of New York State where the ambition is so right on. So I just appreciate all the work you're doing, supporting the college, supporting the state, and really supporting our planet. So briefly, I'm sure you're all aware, climate is changing. We've seen about 1 degree Celsius global temperature rise since the late 1800s. I always like to point out that Eunice Foote, who was a female private scientist, citizen, part of the women's suffrage movement back in the late 1800s, was the first to diagnose the evidence for CO2 giving rise to climate change. And she was right from Seneca Falls. You can go see her statue sometime if you go visit. So really great history in New York State. And then of course at Cornell, the land grant, Carl Sagan, all of us have been thinking about this challenge for a long time. The thing I like to point out is this is the observation of measurements. This is what climate change would be like in the blue without any greenhouse gases. So unequivocal evidence that greenhouse gases are in the driver's seat. Second, I was part of a recent study where now we have 99.9% confidence among the scientific community that climate is caused by human activities principally. That was based on recognition software going through all the peer-reviewed publications. We sorted through 88,000 scientific articles, and we could only find, I think, three that suggested that climate was caused by something else. So high confidence there. And we know that the impacts are here and they're growing. This is a study that was produced by one of our expert researchers, professors in the College of Agriculture and Life Sciences in the Dyson School, showing that already about a fifth or 20% of our crop system has been lost to global climate change. That's likely to increase without mitigating the rise in warming temperature to about half of global crop production failures worldwide if we don't do anything. So for the remainder of this, I'm going to quickly talk about where I see the future and this future that is happening today, one where agriculture, innovation, industry, circular economies come together and provide a weapon in the fight against climate. This is the CLCPA. I'm sure you're all familiar. This was a talk given by Commissioner Ball. And what you can see here is that we have the carbon sinks in forestry and agriculture that are estimated in the past, what we're anticipating can happen by 2030, and then look at this 2050 estimate. So we have to more than double carbon sequestration in our natural and working lands in the state to meet the ambitions of CLCPA. This is not an easy thing to accomplish. It's possible, but it's going to take a lot of effort. And we also know that soil can be a part of the solution. There's a lot of excitement about soil. Never in my life did I imagine so many people would talk about soil at all sectors of society. So it's amazing. I also want to emboss the point that there is still a huge amount of science that's needed to underpin these solutions and make sure they are effective. Two highlights I want to point out. One is biochar. I know you're all familiar with biochar, which is taking waste products, biomass waste, manure waste, repurposing it in a kiln through pyrolysis, gasifying the material to produce energy, and taking the biochar substrate and putting it back in the soil for benefits. A lot of this work has happened through the New York Soil Health Institute, the first of its kind in the United States, which is housed at Cornell, and the pyrolysis demonstration that Professor Johannes Lehmann has developed at Cornell. So I would encourage all you to come and check it out sometime. It's really a wonderful example of where we can take waste and create a circular economy. Second, there are other opportunities that we're working on in the college. This is one that is near and dear to my heart. It's called enhanced weathering, taking natural geologic carbon science and hitting the accelerator on it by repurposing rock dust from the mining industry into soils, which can then securely lock up carbon for thousands and thousands of years. This is an emergent technology that holds incredible promise in terms of bending the carbon curve. So finally, I'll just say that there's a lot of science, there's a lot of innovation, there's a lot of entrepreneurship that's happening in this space, but certainly we know that farmers need to get paid for the carbon services they're providing. We can't ask them to do these things and work with the margins they're working on without a really good carbon price coming their way. This is an article I wrote, an op-ed on this in The Hill, which you can check out. But we know that some things are starting to happen, like in Hudson Carbon, where there is payment for carbon going to farmers, and we need just a lot more of that to support and accelerate these innovations. So that's all I have today. I really appreciate the time to give you an incredibly fast tour of a lot of the excitement, and happy to take any questions, or perhaps you have to move on in the agenda.
You're muted, Michelle.
I am, thank you. No, thank you so much for being here. And I know we could spend hours on this topic, so giving it 5 minutes is a disservice, but I thought it was important to scratch the surface, really open the door for us to hear and learn more. And I know this is a really important topic for many of our members. So thank you so much for that overview. Senator May.
Yeah, just very quickly, I was intrigued by your last comment about the dust from mining. Is that happening in New York State? Is that something we can see happening?
Great question. Well, you know, I started a project over 100 acres with rock dust in California, and we've now started establishing it in industrial hemp operations here at Cornell Agritech. Yes, there's a huge potential with wolastonite tailings and rock dust that has accumulated. We estimate that globally, there's enough rock dust that's already been accumulated through building and manufacturing to sequester billions of tons of CO2 if it was repurposed. New York State has a lot of geologic substrate that is beneficial to this process. So we are working on it, and I think a lot could happen in that space for sure.
So we have a lot of limestone quarries in my district. Is that even a possibility, or would that take us in the wrong direction?
Well, you know, Senator May, I hate to say that that's not going to be a good possibility, but limestone is not the best. What we really need are volcanically derived rocks. But wollastonite, which is up in the Adirondacks, is really a great opportunity. But anything that's fundamentally volcanic in origin would work for this process.
Great. Thank you.
Yep.
Senator Comrie, I saw your hand. Did you have a question?
I was going to ask if we could get a copy of the presentation. And if there's a possibility that they could link this so that we could send it out to our schools in the area as well. So
100%. Thank you.
Senator Borello.
Thank you. Just quickly, I want to say really just a comment. Thank you for this quick presentation. I'm intrigued by this and largely because I'm very concerned that our farmers are under a lot of pressure to convert their land, and the only crop that they're going to have someday is going to be wind turbines and solar panels. And I think that coming up with alternatives to carbon sequestration and issues that will address that continues this to be fertile farmland, is going to be very important going forward, because you can see the pressure from the solar speculation that's going on throughout New York State, especially. So just want a quick comment from you on that. I mean, in my opinion, I think you're never going to sequester the same amount of carbon with solar panels as you would with having farmers actively doing it. I'm just wondering your thoughts on that, of the loss of farmland versus alternatives like this.
Yep, tricky set of issues. The college is working hard on this with our stakeholders. Obviously we need to support the food sector. We understand how important agriculture is in New York State, but also just imagine the pandemic if we didn't have local food when it first struck. So we have to do both. And I know that sounds a little bit in the middle, but I really believe in building bridges here. And I think that there are ways you can site solar, you can sequester carbon, we continue to grow food if we're thoughtful in our design. Uplifting our rural economy through a new carbon-based system would be terrific. I think that's a great way to build society. And I think we're ambitious on that point.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I'll just say, the statistic about a fifth of our food supply is now gone because of the climate crisis. Is that in New York State, around the country, or around the world?
Yeah, so that was a US-based study, which is pretty startling. If you go global, it can get worse. Sub-Saharan Africa, areas on the planet which are seeing incredible droughts and whiplash events mixed with flooding. I've spent a lot of time in sub-Saharan Africa, and frankly, it's devastating to see what's happening. They don't have resilience, but globally, the numbers are looking like if we do nothing, we'll see 50% reduction in our food supply by 2050. And of course, we could have 10 billion people at that time too. So this is an area where agriculture has a vested interest in helping to bend the carbon curve as quickly as possible. And I think that based on the scientific evidence, no industry is better prepared or poised to get carbon out of the air and produce co-benefits for environment, nutrition, and people than agriculture. So we're excited about the future of agriculture. We know R&D is going to be fundamental to making that happen.
And I'm sorry, did you say, you said 50% by 2050?
Yeah, many studies point to a 50% reduction in global crops supplies. Now, of course, people will adjust. We're seeing indoor agriculture. We're seeing a lot of ways that we can help adapt our farming sector to some of these challenges. But it is something that we're already seeing today. We estimate around 800 million people on the planet woke up today without food. So we're very fortunate in the United States to have such a healthy agricultural system.
Those numbers are startling, and I think makes it, especially as we look at, and you know this better than anyone, as we look at the effects of the climate crisis and where even within our country, we're seeing that from flooding in Florida and fires in California and droughts in the Midwest. New York agriculture is critically important, seems like a very important cornerstone to the future of our food supply, especially with the impending impacts of climate. Would you agree?
Well, I think that was very well put, Senator. I couldn't have put it any better myself. And the fact is, agriculture is incredibly vulnerable to weather. That's how we grow food. And so if weather changes, it pulls the fabric of society apart. You know, we take food for granted sometimes because you can DoorDash it, or you can, you know, just go to your fridge if you're in Silicon Valley and find everything you want. But it doesn't, we take it for granted. And it is the basic building block of our economy. And we have to protect our food. It's also a huge national security issue. If the food sector unravels, it doesn't take long before a lot of our national security apparatus is in trouble too.
Thank you. I could keep talking with you about this topic all day, but I think this is just the beginning. Obviously, these conversations are happening, but hopefully the beginning of these conversations with this, with our committee and you to figure out the types of legislations and protections we need to put in place to make sure not just that we are using every tool in our toolbox, especially sequestration with agriculture to fight the climate crisis, but really preserving our agricultural land as well so that we can sequester the carbon, but also make sure we have a food supply across our country.
Great.
Thank you very much. And if anybody has any questions, follow-up questions, we will make sure you are in touch with the dean. And thank you. We'll make sure that presentation is also circulated.
Great. Thanks for your leadership, everyone. It's so important. And New York State is in a great position to lead on this challenge. So thanks for all the work you're doing.
Thank you very much. Yep. All right. And now jumping right in. Well, and one thing I'll actually say jumping right in to our bill, we've taken some time. We have three bills on our committee agenda today. Clerk, can you read our first bill?
Absolutely. Senate Bill 7861 by Senator May, an act to direct the Department of Agriculture and Markets in cooperation with the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority to develop and produce guidance and educational materials on the use of agrivoltaics in farming.
Great, and I think one thing I'll say is all three, but two of these bills specifically, I think really speak to what we just heard in the presentation of both working to fight the climate crisis as well as preserving our farmland. So I think the agenda bodes really well today together. Any questions or comments on this bill? Senator May.
I just want to say thank you for bringing both of these bills forward. I think, if we can figure out ways that we can be creating energy and food, together, that's a really important thing. And as you said, has the potential to address some of the issues we just heard about.
Motion to move the bill.
Great. We have a motion to move the bill from Senator Comrie. Do we have a second? Seconded by Senator Borello. All in favor of reporting this bill?
Aye.
Aye, great. Opposed? AWRs? That one AWR from Senator Helming? The clerk will read the results.
8 ayes, 1 AWR, 0 opposed.
Thank you very much. This bill is reported to the floor. Clerk will read our second bill.
Senate Bill 8084 by Senator Hinchey, an act to amend the Agriculture and Markets Law and the Cannabis Law in relation to providing a conditional adult use cultivator license and a conditional adult use processor license.
Any questions or comments on this bill? Senator Borello.
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chair. first of all, I'm in favor of this bill. Anything that can help our ag industry in particular, and the idea of the hemp growers converting to marijuana, it seems to make sense. But I do have a few questions. First of all, it mentions, at least in the analysis, that they'd be able to sell, but we don't and have any legal dispensaries here. So they're going to grow it. Who are they going to sell it to?
Yeah, I think, and I'll answer, and then maybe staff can chime in if there's something to add. We have to get the industry up and running and by growing it. And so the idea is that the licenses and the dispensaries and such will be up and running by the time this is set, but we have to have product in order to actually start the market, which takes a bit longer. So we know OCM is moving rapidly. I think there was an article this morning that said there could be licenses across the board by the end of 2022 for dispensaries and such. But in order to do that and to be as successful as possible, especially making sure that the product is New York grown, which is the whole point of what we want within the MRTA, that our farmers in New York State are the ones benefiting from this new market, we have to start the grow process early. Is there anything to add, Steph?
You're correct, Senator. And yes, this, the provisional license would give, the provisional cultivator's license gives farmers the authorization to grow. And until June 1st of 2023, they would also have the authorization to process, if it's flower, and distribute. But you are correct, Senator Borrello, there is still the difference between the growing and processing tier and the retail tier. So no, they will not be able to retail. But as Senator Hinchey said, the idea is that there will be licensed retailers for them to sell the product to.
Thank you.
Can I just unpack that for a minute? So we're going to give them in this bill the ability to sell. Now, we all know that right now, because of the way this legislation rolled out, they decriminalized the possession of marijuana. So now we have people that are gifting marijuana to people. You know, you have places where you buy a sticker and then they give you a bag of weed. We also have Native territories selling them. Hundreds of dispensaries have opened on Native territories. Would these people under this law be able to sell to those people that are now selling it through, we'll call it their gray market, if you will, under the way this bill reads?
No, Senator. The gray market is illegal, so all that activity is outside of the current law, and it's not part of the regulated market. And when I said sell, I meant sell to retailers who will then have the ability to sell to the public. These folks are not selling to end users. They will have the ability to take their products and then sell it to the retailers who will then retail it legally.
Okay, but they would not be able to sell it to a dispensary on a Native territory. They would not just be able to sell it to one of these gifting places that have opened up. And by the way, you say it's illegal, but I have yet to hear of anybody being shut down. So I'm not sure how illegal it is at this point.
And Senator, these folks will be participating in the regulated market. So they would be able to sell to regulated dispensaries.
Okay. One last question. You know, it mentions that in order to get this conditional license, you have to comply with the social equity mentorship program and environmental sustainability program. Are those programs in place yet for them to follow? Are there any rules, particularly for the social equity mentorship program? I do have some concerns because when I debated Senator Krueger on this on the floor, I asked her straight up, would this include convicted felons? And she said yes. So I'm a little concerned about someone being essentially forced to bring on a convicted felon in an all cash business as a cultivator or grower.
Council, do you want to start that?
And obviously OCM will have to create and promulgate the rules and regulations of any mentorship program. But Senator, nowhere in the bill does it state that individual farmers would be forced to interact with convicted felons if they did not so, you know, wish. And I think the point of any sort of mentorship program is to expand the base of people who will be participating in this business.
And one thing I'll add to that too is we know that most of our hemp farmers are white, right? And the point of the MRTA was to also make sure that there is social equity, that we're bringing in a more diverse group of people to actually be growing and supporting and building the agricultural industry. Because we need to start this industry now, building that mentorship program, making sure that additional people, new farmers, beginning farmers, can learn from people who are already doing it, and then become that next set of farmers. We know the average age of a farmer in New York State is 57. We heard that on our 14-hour hearing last night a couple of times. Mentoring is such a critical component right now, and especially as we see the cannabis industry going to what we see across other states of how big this cannabis industry is. We know it's going to be really successful here. We want to make sure that new farmers are getting into this process. And so starting a mentorship program so that we can have more BIPOC farmers in cannabis growing and hemp growing is really important.
And that's great. And I support that 100%. I'm just concerned because, again, when we debated this bill and we unpacked the details of who was considered to be those that were affected by previous drug laws, it really wasn't limited to just people that were, say, convicted of the possession of marijuana or convicted of selling marijuana only. It was people that were really, when I asked the question, hardcore criminals, and that's the part that concerns me. I'm all in favor of bringing more people into farming, and because we do need more farmers, we need young farmers, we need diverse farmers. I just want to make sure that it's very clear that this is a cash business. This is a business that these people have been doing successfully in hemp, and transitioning is going to require a lot of investment on their part. And I just want to be careful. And like I said, I'm in favor of. I just want to be careful what the unintended consequences might be. That's all.
Thank you. The only thing I'll add is, people who are formerly incarcerated, who are out, are getting a second chance, right? This is people who want to get their life together, make the life back on track, and have just as many opportunities, or should have as many opportunities as anybody else, right? They have served their time. They have been released. And we want to make sure that people are successful. Our economy is significantly better when everybody is in the workforce. We know that a crime is down when people are in the workforce. Our economy is stronger when people are in the workforce. And so this new industry, the point of the MRTA was to give, especially people who have been negatively impacted by the war on drugs that was meant to criminalize people of color, have an opportunity to now be part of this new industry. So as council said, though, OCM will have the regulations on what that mentorship program looks like, what that looks like, who is part of it, how people are being connected. So we will see. And I know I have full faith in OCM to make sure that that program is to the best benefit of New York State and the cannabis program at large.
All good. I appreciate that. And with that, I'll move the bill.
Wonderful. Bill is moved by Senator Borello. Do we have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Senator Comrie and Senator May. All in favor of reporting this bill?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or AWRs? We have two. I see a possible trying to unmute, but two AWRs, one AWR, from Senator Jordan and one from Senator Helming. The clerk will read the results.
7 A's, 2 AWR, 0 opposed.
Thank you very much. This bill is now reported to the floor. And the clerk will read our third bill.
Senate Bill 8088 by Senator Hinchy, an act to amend the Agriculture and Markets Law in relation to the construction, installation, and operation of dual-use solar energy projects on certain land which receives an agricultural assessment.
Thank you very much. Any questions or comments on this bill?
Move the bill.
Thank you very much. The bill is moved by Senator Comrie. Is there a second? Seconded by Senator May and Senator Borello. All in favor of reporting this bill?
Aye.
All opposed or AWR?
AWR.
Great. Two AWRs from Senator Jordan and Senator Helming. Clerk will read the results.
7 A, 2 AWR, 0 opposed.
Thank you very much. And that bill is now reported to finance. Thank you all very much. Do we have a motion to close our meeting today?
I move to close. Before we close, I just want to congratulate Chair Hinchy on her statement on previous to the second bill. Clearly, we have to look out for those people that were swept up in the hysteria over drug arrests over the past 20 years. And a main part of this bill is restoration of rights to people that were unfairly incarcerated. So I think I just want to commend you on your response to it. And I'll save my response for another time. But I think that, you know, we have to make sure that if we do restoration in this state, that restoration goes for all people that were impacted and overly impacted by the hysteria around the rest over the last 20 years. So thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Senator Comrie. I think that's exactly right. Well, thank you. All right, motion to close. Thank you all so much for joining the meeting today. We will circulate the presentation from this morning and make sure anyone who is interested for follow-up questions is connected to the dean. And we will be back soon. Thank you all so much.